Yeah, testing 1, 2. This is just a test, just to make sure that the audio is fine. It seems that way to me. We'll be starting in 1 minute. 1 minute, we shall begin. Okay, shall begin now. Good afternoon to one and all here in the congregation, as well as those online. Welcome to this segment of the Thanksgiving service, which will focus on tributes to Paula Omita Blackman. It will consist of tributes in song, instrumentals, video presentations, and voice. Now, my name is Lavon Hines, and I will be your master of ceremonies for this segment of tributes. Permit me to say just a few words. Now, I would have first met Paula back in 1994 when her membership was transferred to the Grape Hall Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I found her to be very professional in her approach as it related to the offices she held in the church, especially in the areas of Sabbath school as the Sabbath school secretary and as a church clerk. She was also very sociable and approachable. As a matter of fact, my late wife Andrea, our children and I had a special connection with Paula, Steve, and Carrie-Anne. Now, Paula was a dedicated and committed member of Grape Hall Seventh-day Adventist Church, and you could depend on her for any assistance, solicited and unsolicited. She will be sorely missed and definitely not forgotten. On behalf of the Hines family, that is, Jaleesa Hines, Fabia Hines, and me, Lavon Hines, I want to offer sincere condolences to Brother Steve, Carrie Ann, other members of the Blackman family, the White family, and other family members and friends on the passing of Paula Omita Hines. May she sleep until Jesus comes. Now, this evening, we're going to start our tributes with a video presentation from a man by the name of Terry Blackman. He is the cousin of Brother Steve Blackman, the husband of the deceased, and it will be in the form of a video. He resides in the USA, and I want you to focus on the screen behind me as he presents his tribute to Paula Omita Blackman. Thank you. USA. Next up will be a solo, and this now will be by the nephew of Brother Steve. And to perform this solo is Mr. Israel Allen. Come on to the stage, Mr. Allen.
Can you turn up? Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I'll never know just why he came to love me so. Beyond my faults and so my needs, and I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary. For me, how marvelous the grace that bought my falling soul. He looked beyond my thoughts and saw my need. Shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I'll never know just why Christ came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my needs, and I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary. For me. healing soul. Heal, Lord, beyond my faults and so my needs. He looked beyond my thoughts and so my need. Oh, so my needs.
God bless you.
That was excellent singing. It reminds me of when I was young. You know, I was, you know, was a singer, and I sang somewhat like him. Beautiful singing, Mr. Allen. I might have to work something out with you. Let's move on. Now, Paula, she worked at the National Housing Corporation. And so at this time, we want to invite Mr. Roger Ward to come to the podium. He's the project manager, project coordinator at the National Housing Corporation. Please welcome Mr. Roger Ward.
Good evening to the congregation on this solemn occasion. On reflecting on the loss of a friend and examining what true friendship is, the below passages and quote stood out to me. To my mind, they best reflect what true friendship is and clearly demonstrate the type of friend Paula Omidia Blackman Nair White was. Ecclesiastes 4:9-10 states, two are better than one. They have a good reward for the labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe unto him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath nothing, for he has no other to help him up. Aristotle said, without friends, no one would choose to live, though he had all other goods. Paula was one to always lift others. I first met Paula when I joined the corporation at the beginning of May 1981. Some 40 years ago. Paula had been with the organization 6 months prior, and from inception, Paula and I struck up a friendship. She was assigned to the registry, and I to the personnel department. In those days, our offices were not as salubrious as they are now, but there was always warmth and camaraderie. There was a group of us in those days who gravitated towards one another, consisted of the likes of Paula, Wendy Rock, Cassandra Phillips, myself, and a few others. We were guided and mentored by an amazing group of seasoned employees, such as Mervyn Yearwood, Marva Hunt, Tyra McIntosh, Anne Hope, and Cynthia Holder. I've often credited this group for the direction both Paula and I took within the organization. The friendship between Paula and I was further cemented during the first half of 1982, when I was assigned to join her in the registry of the corporation. Paula guided me through the process of handling all of the corporation's mail, its insurance portfolio, and the management of the corporation's filing system. I credit her with helping me to achieve the success and progression I've enjoyed within the corporation ever since then. Paula was an amazing person, a human being, always equipped with a charming smile and a pleasant personality. One could have easily mistaken her quiet demeanor for someone who was an easy pushover. Nothing could be further from the truth. For while she constantly wore a smile and a charming disposition, she was not one to be trifled with. She was firm, but fair. She was not afraid to stand her ground on matters she felt merited firm response and action, but at the end, one never felt prejudiced or treated inhumanely. On Tuesday, May 18th, 2021, on learning of Paula's death, a solemnness transcended the corporation. We had lost one of the ladies of the organization. Raymond Lord, our planner, quipped in a quiet reflection, "We don't write the script." Of course, he was referring to the fact that we don't get to choose or control when we leave this earth. Paula may not have written that script, but she certainly punctuated that script. She punctuated that script with what we call in life character, humility, purpose, and steadfastness. Our friendship has never dimmed despite our different paths within the organization, and her death will certainly not extinguish it. To Steve, Kerry, and all of Paula's siblings, we extend sympathy and condolences. I say, your loss is our loss. We grieve with you, but know the accomplishments and achievements of Paula are worth celebrating. I extend to all of you heartfelt condolences. Know that today is not the end, but the beginning of a new chapter. Rest in peace, Paula, forever loved. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ward. Next is a young man from the Grape Hall Seventh-day Adventist Church. His name is Raphael Boyce, and he will come to the podium now, and he will render to us a tribute to Paula in song. Brother Raphael Boyce. Be cool. Thank you very much, Raphael. Now, I just want to say this to all of us. As I said earlier, the pandemic is still here, and we have to observe the protocols. And it has been observed that a few persons are not wearing their masks correctly. So I encourage all of us to please wear a mask correctly. When I was a boy, I loved this instrument, the pan, steel pan. This evening, we have two gentlemen, Ricardo Bryan and David Walcott, and they will render an instrumental piece on the keyboard and the steel pan. Ricardo Bryan and David Walcott. Thank you, Ricardo and David. Wonderful rendition. Someday I would want to learn to play the pan. Now, I am told that when Paula first went to the National Housing Corporation to work, a young lady took her under her wing and showed her the ropes. And coming out of this interaction at work, Paula and this young lady became wonderful friends. I'm told she no longer works at the National Housing Corporation. However, today, to give another tribute to Paula Omita Blackman is none other than Paula's good friend, Miss Ann Hope. Please welcome Miss Ann Hope.
Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Paula joined the staff of National Housing Corporation on 1st December 1980 and was assigned to the administration department. This quiet young lady would have to pass by my work area to get to her own. Over time, a relationship developed and I saw her like one of my younger siblings. A personnel department was updated and the registry was created. Miss Fiona Goodridge was transferred from accounts to personnel, and Miss Althea Seale was transferred from housing management to join Paula in the registry. The four of us live as a family up until this day. We would often joke and say we did not go looking for our friends. We were put together. A young man named Erskine Springer worked at housing for a short period. During this period, he would visit my desk and engage me in some interesting discussion. One day, he informed me that he was going to live in the United States and told me Paula was his cousin and asked me to take care of her. We never had discussion about Paula, so I was surprised by this tall order. I will share a few personal moments of Paula and myself. One morning, she came to my desk and handed me a folded piece of paper and instructed me not to open it until she had returned to her desk. I did as was instructed. When I read it, the note said, "I am pregnant." Immediately, I went to her desk and I shared as an older sibling was. I told her this was just a bump in the road and that it would not stop her from achieving anything she wanted to achieve. End of conversation. Out of this pregnancy came a beautiful little girl, Carrie Ann. Some years later, she came in very excited and shared with me that she had committed her life to the Lord. She was excited and I was happy. This started what would be a new and committed journey in the Adventist family. Third one was, she told me about a young man from church she was talking to. I was later introduced to him, and his name was Steve. This relationship blossomed to the stage of proposal. She later told me they were getting married. She told me her parents asked her if she had shared the news with me. Sometime in the planning, she posed this question to me. If I go away and get married, how would you feel? I told her, if you are happy, I am happy. I later told her that on their return, whether it was day or night, they would stop by my home. When the newlyweds returned, They stopped and were surprised as we welcomed this new family with a celebration. Whenever I celebrated a milestone, be it 50, 60, or 70 years, I would take one or two persons from relatives and the church family because of the size of my family. But there was always an exception with the Blackman family. All three would be invited. On my last celebration 2 years ago, Paula's gift to me was a live performance of a saxophonist, and he played beautifully. My relationship with Paula was such that if there was a difference of opinion in a matter, person or persons telling me about it would preface their remarks with, "I know you like Paula," before speaking on the matter. Paula loved her family, her parents and siblings, but dearest to her was her husband, Steve, and daughter, Carrie Ann, as they love her. I thank God for her life and for having met and enjoyed a friendship of our working life, and even after my retirement more than 8 years ago. Paula would normally send me inspirations. I do not normally reply to such, but I made an exception with Paula. On the 16th of May, she sent me a WhatsApp message informing me she had received a diagnosis. I responded from the Word of God. She responded with Amen. On the 17th of May, I sent a prayer from the Word of God, and she showed appreciation and thanked me. But later that morning, she called and asked me to pray, which I was planning to do as soon as we had ended the conversation. But she wanted to pray while we were still on the phone. On the 18th, I sent a blessing from the Word of God and added a prayer consisting of one sentence. That was our last contact. I close with this quote from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 and 14. "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus." That was the New King James. The Amplified puts it this way: "No, we do not want you to be uninformed, believers, about those who are asleep or in death, so that you will not grieve for them as the others do, who have no hope beyond this life. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, as in fact he did, even God, in this same way, by raising them from the dead, will bring with them those believers who have fallen asleep in Jesus." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Miss Hope. A young man from the Grape Hall Seventh-day Adventist Church will now come forward and render a saxophone solo. His name is Akin Burke. Please welcome Akin Burke to the stage, please. Thank you. Wonderful playing. Our final tribute is in the form of a video, and this is from the Great Hall, Seventh Day Adventist Church. Now, Brother Steve, Carrie Ann, and the family, please pay attention to the tribute from the screen. And this, as I said, is from the Great Hall, Seventh Day Adventist Church, is the final tribute, and immediately following the Thanksgiving service for the life of Paula Omita Blackman shall begin.
Our beloved Sister Paula Omita Blackman Nee White was nurtured in the Great Hall Seventh-day Adventist Church. Having been received into its membership on February 15, 1994, on transfer from our sister church at Gardens St. James, where she was baptized and accepted into fellowship on November 13, 1982. She grew in Christian maturity amongst our brethren and served the church and community in many capacities, including, but not limited to, Sabbath school ministry, women and children's ministries, community services, deaconry, and personal ministries. Her greatest mark, however, was made when she served our congregation as its church clerk, while at the same time being a human resources management professional at the National Housing Corporation, a wife to Steve, a mother to Carrie Ann, a friend to many, and above all, a servant of God. She played her part with vigor and sincerity. Her welcoming and endearing smile was a characteristic that easily defined her. She was friendly, outgoing, and hospitable. She was generous to a fault, tender-hearted, charitable, and punctual. She possessed outstanding moral values and was a very sensitive, selfless, and compassionate person. She was the consummate family person and supported her husband and daughter in their every endeavor. Joining me in these sentiments and expressions of condolences are our pastor, Haldane Graves, our elders, Rorick Boyce and Claudston Abel, the board and members of the church, as well as the extended members of the church family. Paula has always impressed me as a person of great courage and resilience. She wrestled with God in prayer for her family, for her friends, for her colleagues, calling on the church for assistance. God has laid his faithful soldier to rest. But this text fits her to a T. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith.
Sister Paula was one of the nicest young ladies I have ever met. She always had a smile and something positive to say. I will miss her visits, calls and prayers.
My first impression of hers began when I first saw her in the hospital visiting Steve, and then in church. I noticed that she was a person who didn't speak a lot, but whenever she did speak, what she said was to the point, and I could feel the passion that she spoke with.
My sister in Christ and friend of many years, a person who loved to work for God and others. I would text her a prayer or Bible verse, or share a song with comforting and encouraging words. Her last words to me were, "I want my friends and those I love to pray for me." And we did. May she rest in peace.
I will remember Paula in many positive ways. She was very approachable and friendly.
I found Paula to be very friendly and articulate when it came to her church work. She will be greatly missed.
Peaceful, optimistic, loyal, loving, and adorable. Paula is gone, but her memory will live on. Our hearts may fail, our spirits may grow weak, but God remains our strength. He is ours forever.
Paula was the kind of person who was unassuming and kind of in the background. But this never stopped her from giving of her best to whatever task she was given to complete to give God glory. She was also a woman of great faith. Every Wednesday night, she would present a list of names of friends, families, and foe who needed prayer, asking the church to join with her as we prayed for everyone, to her husband and daughter, families. Have faith that we will meet again on that great resurrection day. May she rest in peace.
We've lost a part of our family. We're going to miss Paula's quiet strength and presence among us. Even though she's not physically with us, she will always be in our hearts as we surround her husband and daughter with our continued love. Please accept our most heartfelt condolences.
Paula was a very dedicated person who took her responsibilities as a deaconess very seriously, always willing to put in the extra time, especially after communion services. She would truly be missed. May she rest in peace.
Friendship isn't about who you've known the longest. It's about who walked into your life and said, "I am here for you," and proved it. Paula was such a friend. Gone, but not forgotten, till we meet again.
Today, I'm truly saddened by the passing of my dear sister in Christ, Sister Paula, one whom I prayed with, laughed with, who played an integral role in the community services department. Her hope was built on Jesus Christ and righteousness. I look forward to meet her when the role is called up yonder.
My relationship with Paula stretches back to 2013 when I joined the church at Lip Hall. Paula was not only my friend, but more like a daughter, very caring and attentive. Her smiling face, prayers, hugs, and comforting words are already being missed.
After Paula was admitted to hospital, we would talk and pray with each other every day. I was privileged to hear her voice for the final time, just before her passing. I told her I love her, and she said, "I love you too." She told me to remember to ask for God's protection every second of the day, because Satan is busy creating mischief, but God is good. That was my Paula. She always showed love and concern to everyone, even to her very end.
Paula was a quiet individual, known to all as a loving, caring wife and a very supportive mother. To Steve and Carrie Ann, I offer my sincerest support as I keep you always in my prayers. May she rest in peace.
On behalf of the Griffith family, we would like to extend our sincerest condolences to the Blackman and White families on the passing of Paula Blackman. Paula was a true gem of a lady. She always let us know how much she cared. She has definitely gone way too soon.
Paula was a very thoughtful and loving person. She would try to assist others before even thinking about herself. My sincere condolences to her family.
We are saddened by the loss of our dear family friend. However, we hold on to memories of wonderful times we shared together. A life well lived. We will surely meet again. Sleep in peace, Sister Paula.
Paula, P. Pleasant to be around. O. Optimistic in her views. L. Loving her neighbor as herself. L. Loved by everyone. A. Adorable in her kindness. She will be greatly missed. May she rest in peace.
We will all miss her immensely. While we now mourn, we do not do so as those who have no hope. For we look forward to that blessed day when the angels will rejoice and the Lord will say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord." May she rest in peace.
Let's all stand, please. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you.
We give God thanks for the life of Sister Paula Omita Blackman. There are questions in life that we always say that we don't have answers for. But we serve a God who knows the end from the beginning. We serve a God who understands our hurt, our pain, the agony that we go through. And all we can say is God is still in control. On behalf of the many guests here, the many persons from the community, her fellow staff, members of the Household of Faith, we express our profound sympathies to the Blackman family, to Brother Steve and to Kerry, and to the extended family. We extend our sympathies. And our prayer is that the Lord Jesus, who has led you thus far, will continue to hold you up and to strengthen your resolve to keep trusting in him. May the God of heaven comfort you, Brother Steve. May the God of heaven comfort you, Kerry, and all the members. May the peace that passeth all understanding abide with you. God bless you. Keep hope alive. One day soon, death will die. Our hymn of acknowledgement and our hymn to give God praise is number, is the very first song in your brochure. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. That's our very first song. Let's sing it. And by the way, we are still upholding protocols. I know that the government of Barbados spells out clearly 3 feet apart, except for family. So wear your mask, sanitize, don't shake hands, just bump. God bless you. Let's sing that song. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Standing as we invite Shaquille Dougling to bring us the first scripture lesson.
Good evening, everyone.
first scripture reading is taken from Psalm 121, and it reads, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thee from evil, from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in, from this time forth and even forevermore. Here ends the scripture reading.
Shall we reverently bow our heads for prayer? Eternal Father and God, Father who created life, and also recognized that because of sin, death would come. But because of your love, because of your gratitude, because of your protection, because of your care, you inspired the psalmist to write, even though we pass through the valley over which the shadow of death is cast, we need not fear because you are God of the living also. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And those who give themselves to you will not only live in this world and die, but there is also eternal life in the future. We recognize then that death, in the words of Jesus, is just asleep. And there will be a morning more glorious than the night of human suffering and pain. And so we've come together this evening to pay our final regards and respect. We've come to grieve the passing of our dear friend, wife, mother. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you will be with the family members, the husband, and all the family members, and all of us as friends, and help us to be comforted, knowing that there will be a resurrection. There will be a time when we will be together again. And so this evening is just a goodbye, as it were. And we look forward to that glorious morning when the night of human suffering would have come to an end and we would be together forever and ever. So bless us all, and may this service bring comfort to all who mourn. Bring hope to those who feel in despair. May it answer the questions that we have, and may we rest assured in the comfort of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. This we pray, and this we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Be seated.
At this time, you shall be favored with an item of special music by Brother Woodsley Griffith.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Through the long dark night.
as I face the raging seas, the anchor holds in spite of the storm. I've had visions and I've had dreams. I've even held them in my hand, but I never knew they would slip right through, as they were only grains of sand.
Can you give Jose another big amen, please, everybody? What a magnificent and remarkable song. Continue singing for the Lord, Jose. This time, the time for tributes. We have Pastor Dale Haynes, National Housing, Carrie Ann Boyce, followed by Steve Blackman. On behalf of my family and me, I want to extend my deepest and heartfelt condolences to the friends and the family, all those who grieve. I want to move this tribute in two parts. One, the first part will be Paula, the church professional. I remember when I first came to, then it was the St. Lucie district. It was in 2005. I am not one to engage in hyperbole or exaggeration,
But when I came, when I went there, that then the St. Lucie district of Checker Hall, Chancel, Grape Hall, and Northern Light. When I got there, my mother's features were still on my face, and my breath was still smell of Cerelac. I was young in ministry, very young in ministry. And I came to the Grape Hall Church and met a professional in Paula. And she was, when I was there for the 4 years, the church clerk for that time. Paula was simply brilliant. Paula was the one to be very bring a calming effect on the board, lest there be muscular discussion. But she was one that was ever present. Every meeting, Paula was present. Not only that too, she had that smile that would calm things down, but she always knew the whereabouts for the church. And Paula was that consummate church professional as she led out being the church clerk for the church. And another part is Paula, the encourager. When I left the district in 2009, we kept in contact with the remarkable family of you, Steve, and Carrie Ann. And every level, every step I took, Paula was there to encourage me. Paula was there to come along or call or say, Pastor, how you doing? And any project that I launched, Paula was there to give me that support. So this evening, Paula was truly a church professional. And Paula was truly an encourager. I extend my condolences to you and to all of you. I know truly that weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning. So National Housing, Carrie Ann Boyce, and then Steve Blackman.
A blessed good afternoon to everyone. My name is Sophia Cobham-Haynes. I am a colleague and friend of Miss Carrie-Anne Boyce. I shall be reading her tribute on her behalf. I met Paula Omita White on the 20th of December, 1985. Yes, when she gave birth to me. I am assured that we both had an overwhelming response of love to each other. She was there for me every time I needed her. She was always, to my mind, a very loving and kind-hearted person. I am sure that there are many here who feel the same way about my mother, Paula. Some mothers are only mothers in name. My mother was a mother by name and nature. She took her position as nurturer and provider quite seriously. In every stage of my life, she supported me. She was always by my side from primary school to even recently when I was studying for my bachelor's in education at the Barbados Community College. My mother had several hobbies. She enjoyed cooking, reading, watching the good movie, and of course, our Sunday drives through the country. She loved her family. She felt that families should support each other, and she did this on many occasions. Her faith in God was very strong. She made sure that I was also very active in church so that I would have a relationship with God. This was what Mummy wanted for me, to ensure that I did not stray too far away from God. She was involved in many church activities and held many positions in church, from church clerk, Sabbath school secretary, and deaconess. These positions showed the depth of her commitment to the work of the Lord and to the church family. Mummy understood me. She could tell when I was sad, happy, disappointed, or even frustrated. I recall coming home from rough days at school, and Mummy would recognize that I needed a lift in spirits. On days like this, we would go to Chefette Barbecue Barn and relax for a while. By the end of the outings, not only would I feel better, but we would come up with ways to resolve the situation. That was simply Mummy. She had the innate ability to comfort me through it all. She was always very proud of my personal and academic achievements. She always told me I could do all things through Christ who strengthens me. She would always help me with my schoolwork and encourage me never to give up. All my life, I've had challenges with my health. Many parents may have felt frustrated, but not my mother. She was always there when I was sick. She constantly reassured me that everything would be all right. When she was faced with her health issues, we confronted them together. I was with her through every appointment or visit to the doctor's office. Here is a simple poem that expresses my feelings and thoughts. My mother was always helpful, not only to me and my family, but to anyone who needed assistance. I admire the way she spoke. With such wisdom, knowledge, and authority, she shared her experiences with everybody who required it. That was Mummy. She carried herself with quiet dignity. She loved to dress and to express her individuality, and she taught me to dress impeccably. Whether for church, work, or a dinner, she carried herself like a winner. That was Mummy. She was a homemaker. That was her priority. She maintained her house efficiently. She taught me to never give up on my dreams, never to believe that I was not good enough or worthy enough. That was Mummy. I was proud of her academic achievements, her successes in the work environment that showed me the value of commitment, to reaching for the skies, to never let anyone or any situation hinder me from doing my best, and on my laurels not to rest. That was Mummy. I will never forget her warm smile, welcoming all into her world of love and acceptance. That was Mami. Mom, I just want to say to you that you were the unique being who understood me and remained by my side always. I will truly miss you. Rest in peace and rise in glory. I thank you.
Everybody, it's a bit hard here for myself, no, but I'm going to do my best. I don't have a long, long list that everybody has. I have a few pointers that I want to share with you. And the 16th of June, 1979, I gave my life to the Lord in baptism. When I did that, I told God, I'm going to serve you. Can't want me. Don't care what happened. Because every person had me as a bad boy with drugs and such more. So no person thought that I would go to church and stop in church. So I got 2 weeks, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, a year. On the 16th of June, this month, before 2 years that I'm still serving God. You know what? But it was not only me who caused that. Paula was there for me all the way, encouraging me, you know, by my side, telling me good things that I want to hear. And you know that, but times when she had to tell me something that was not quite liking, she was still telling me. And so when I gave my life to the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm going to serve you. But there's 3 things in life that I want, and I'm going to ask you for them. And the first thing that I asked God for was a good wife. And I received that. Yes. I asked her for a home, not only a house, but for a home. And she did that as well. This may sound a bit harsh, but I tell God that I want a car as well. Because I love driving. I'm not riding, man, but I just love driving. And to give that. And then last, there were 3, 4 things. The last thing that I wanted was a family. I didn't get children, but I still have a stepdaughter. And I want to thank God for all those things. I already know that Paula was exceptional. I believe that I found the best woman in the world. I mean, other men may think otherwise. But I felt from my heart that I have found the best woman in my life. And I always say that if I had to marry again tomorrow, the only person I want to marry is Paula again. And that is from my heart. I can remember I was sick in the early 90s. I was really sick. And I was in the hospital for 17 weeks. I lost a kidney. That time, Paul, my friend, was starting to become friends. I was courting. And I was working at National Housing every evening at Paul Lee work. She would come to the hospital and sit down, pull a chair, and sit beside me every evening that she lived work. And then sometime at midday, she would come. If my family come there to want to speak something, they had to speak because she did, because she was not moving at all. She wasn't moving at all. She was there by my side in thick and in thin. And then I tell her, I want to marry her. And she started to cry. And I said, she asked me if that is true. I said, yes. And I went to her home and I told her father, Mrs. Springer, I want to marry your daughter. He said to me, listen to me carefully. You know, he was a tall man and big. And he said, listen to me. He said, she, She is my daughter and she's a nice woman. If you plan to treat her bad, let her stop here. Don't write so. And that kind of tone. And I said to him, no, I love her. I'm going to treat her good because she got to be my wife. I'm going to marry her because she has to be by my side, not to beat her and that. And he said, all right. And we went and we got married in St. Vincent. And then we came back. We lived a really, 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 really good life. I say that Paula was a woman that looked out for the house. If Paula sees something her want doing, she would do it. She would call Carrie Ann and she would call myself and say, look, this is what we do. What I love about her was that she never did things by herself. She always called her family and she would say, look, this is what we want to do. What we think, and that can be so. And so I have found a virtuous woman. When you read Proverbs 31:10, I think that the psalmist who was in the portion I read the Proverbs was speaking about Paula, because everything that he wrote, she had all those qualities of a good woman, a good mother, a good wife, a good family person. And I would like to let you all know that she even caused me not to leave church, not that I don't want to leave church, but she encouraged me, we encouraged one another to stay in church. And I tell myself, look, if God can save me and know nothing, a man that couldn't hardly talk, you know, I believe and I know for sure that God can save all of us. You know, I know that for sure. I'm not coming here to preach this afternoon, but I'm telling that God, this is God. He can save any person. If he can save Paul, who persecuted a Christian, if he can save me, who was a nobody, I want to tell you, friends of mine, this evening, that God can save you. That's a message. I don't come only to talk to Paul, but I come to talk to you and let you know that God wants to save all of us. The reason why I am saying that, because if you look at the time that we're living in, we don't have much time. You know? So let us better opportunity in serving God in spirit and truth. Let us serve Him. You know what I mean? This is the invitation I'm giving this afternoon. Let's serve God in spirit and truth. And I know that if Paula was here, with somebody inside, she would say the same thing. And so, in closing, I want to let you know that I have loved this woman to my heart. Apart from God, the only person I love that much was Paula. I love her from my heart. It had nothing that I wouldn't do for her. And I know that sometimes she was working and I was done work at the postman and she told me I work in late. I don't care what time I get home. I put a motorcycle down, take out the car, and again with she. I forgot to stop 5 hours because I love her. Because who she was. A lady. A Christian lady. Thank you very much.
What a pleasant evening. However, good morning, Barbados host. At this point in time, would give us the eulogy, Pearson Bowen.
I know, like you, he had me for a moment. He's like, what? Morning? And for me, it's pretty difficult following from daughter and husband. You're asking yourself, what else he could talk about now? I asked myself as I sat there as well. But, you know, as cousin, perhaps I know just a little bit more about Paula that they don't necessarily know. The truth is that Paula Omita Blackman, née White, was born on the 8th day of January, 1963, to who is my uncle Vincent Springer and Ernesta Dean Springer. Paula was the third of 10 siblings, 5 girls, 5 boys, mirroring my experience as well. I'm one of 10 children, 5 girls and 5 boys. Paula received her early education at the St. Albans Primary and Leacock Private School. I do too. She completed her secondary school education at the Community High School, and later she attained her studies at the Barbados Level Institute and the Barbados Community College. Paula has never been one to rest on her laurels. And so she enrolled in the University of the West Indies, where she obtained a Bachelor's of Arts degree and later a Master's of Science in Labor and Employment Relations with the KPL School of Business. As you know, Paula joined the National Housing Corporation at the tender age of 17 and continued her service right there, right up and through until her passing, which really counted for just about 40 years. She was first employed as a clerical officer, but Paula had a determined spirit and was always seeking to improve herself. After years of rising through the ranks, Paula was eventually promoted to the position of Human Resources Manager. Now that appointment gave her a great sense of accomplishment. Paula was, and you'll hear this word a lot, the loving and devoted wife to Steve. She was the loving and cherished mother of her only child, Carrie Ann. She was the loving, protective sister of Patricia, Doriel, Celeste, who predeceased her, Sherma, Lisa, Keith, David, Nigel, Sean, Andre, and Pamelia. And she was the loving, devoted aunt of 24. I heard you. Paula's siblings remember her as being a very quiet child and an ardent reader who loved sightseeing and fine dining. This can be attested to by Steve and Carrie Ann, who both were her chauffeurs, despite Paula having her own driver's license. As long as she did not have to drive, Paula loved to go sightseeing around the island and often enjoyed going to either Martin's Bay or Oystens for a day out. Paula and her nephew Shaquan shared the same birthday of the 8th of January, while her sister Lisa's birthday was on the 7th of January. Tracy, my sister's birthday, was on the 6th of January. Joy, my sister's birthday, is on the 12th of January. My birthday is the 18th of January. Hyacinth's birthday is the 23rd of January. And you know, the list goes on. So you can see lots of similarities there. So all January borns, but we love to celebrate, and Paula surely could. Paula was a Proverbs 31 woman who loved her family. In fact, she believed that there was nothing too good for any of them, and whenever called upon, would assist her family wherever it was, spiritual or financial. Paula loved to cook, especially palau, a talent that she later passed on to Carrie Ann. However, the designation which she cherished most was being servant to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. She dedicated her life to him at a crusade at the Garden Seventh-day Adventist Church in 1982 and was faithful ever since. As Paula was devoted to the service of God, you would often find her working the registration desk at many of the crusades put on by her church of the conference or the conference. You could also find Paula at every open air, every health fair, every crusade ever put on by the church. She would answer the call to whatever position she was nominated for at her church, whether it was Sabbath school teacher, Sabbath school secretary, and prior to her death, the church clerk. Paula left us rather quickly, going into hospital on Thursday the 13th of May this year, before passing on Tuesday the 18th of May. We can only pray that you heard the messages of love, Paula, from your husband, your daughter, your sisters, your brothers, your nieces, your nephews, your friends, your colleagues, your cousins, everyone. We want you, Paula, to know that we love you and we are happy that you are finally out of your pain and that you are resting in glory. Paula did not complain, even though she was in pain. And when she finally received her diagnosis on the 16th of May, that Sunday, she took that opportunity to ask God's forgiveness and to thank him for the life she spent here on earth. I can say that Paula achieved everything she set out for here on earth, a loving husband, a devoted daughter, and family. We're thankful that she got to see two milestones in her daughter's life. One, her appointment as a teacher and earning her bachelor's degree. Paula departed knowing that Steve and Carrie would be loved and looked after by friends and family. This indeed would have brought her a sense of peace. As we reflect on the love that Paula shared with her family and friends, we thank God for her life and her contribution here on earth. We are also glad that she shared her life with us. Rest in peace, Paula. We love you and we will dearly miss you. The family of Paula Omita Blackman, née White, would like now to express heartfelt thank you and appreciation to the management and staff of the National Housing Corporation for being a source of support for Paula during her illness, whether it was a prayer or a phone call. As you know, Revelations 21 verse 4 says, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the older things have passed away." The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He saves those who are crushed in spirit. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. May Paula rest in peace and rise in glory.
Our second scripture reading will be read to us by Carolyn Blackman.
Good afternoon, everyone. The second lesson is taken from Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 9 to 11. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards the heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? The same Jesus, which is taken from you into heaven, shall so come in like the manner as ye had seen him go up into heaven." Here ended the reading.
Standing in solidarity with the Blackman family, we have some of our ministers' wives here to give words of hope. And I want to introduce the pastors' wives who are here. We have my wife, Sister Sandra Graves, and then there's Sister Padmore, and there's Sister Hoyt, and all the other pastors' wives who are here. We acknowledge you. We are thankful for your kind words to the Blackman family, to our brother Steve, and to Kerry. On the platform, for your introduction, for your information, we have on my far left Pastor Dale Haynes, the Person Ministries Director of the East Caribbean Conference. And next to him is Pastor Hoyt, Anthony Hoyt, the pastor of the Breath of Life Jackson Church District. On my far right, we have Pastor Cook, the pastor of the Christ Church District, including Cainville. Next to him is our Person Ministries Leader of the Great Hall Church, and a hard-working elder, Brother Rory Boyce, of the Great Hall Church. And beside him is the president of the East Caribbean Conference, Pastor R. Danford Francis. Very pleased to have him. He gave us the prayer of comfort. And our speaker today is a former pastor of the Minor Quarter Church, former pastor of Great Hall, former pastor of the North. He loves the North. Pastor Leslie Padmore. He's our speaker for today. Before he comes on, though, we're going to have another item of special music from the illustrious choir of the National Housing. Put your hands together for the National Housing Choir. Is it solo? All right. Let's give a big amen. So.
Good afternoon to everyone. And trust me, this will not be a solo. I have no intention of emptying this church this evening. This tribute will be from management of the National Housing Corporation, and dedicated to the life that Paula would have served with us. Some of it well, of, you know, coming on the heels of Carrie Ann, Steve, favorite cousin. Some will be a little bit repetitive, but I'll just skip through some of it that will do so. So on December 1st, 1980, National Housing Corporation engaged the services of Paula White. She came on as a temporary clerical officer, and she was assigned to the administration section. Now, at the time that Paula came in, the corporation was involved in a number of capital projects, and these were all in progress when she came. So Paula's job then was to bring some order to the amount of correspondence being generated as a result of those activities. Indeed, her cousin was quite right. Paula was only 17 years at the time. And she was assigned the task along with input and guidance of Mr. Mervyn Yearwood. And between the two of them, the registry section was birthed. Shortly thereafter, around mid-1981, the corporation sent Paula on a one-week course in registry procedures at the government training division to help equip her with the requisite skills. That registry system was adopted later at the technical section, which was a decentralized office and operating from what was then known as the Clarendon location. That was the location at the base of University Hill, more or less opposite the SO service station. That registry process, as structured then, remains in place and is still effective today at National Housing. Paula was destined to move up the ranks at the National Housing Corporation. As Anne said, she had a bump in the road, but I firmly believe that Carrie Ann's presence resolved Paula's, her whole demeanor and her aim and goal and push for life. So, Paula was quiet, all of us know that, but Paula was fearless and Paula was resolute. Now, how fearless? Why fearless? A little after her four-year anniversary of employment, Paula went on a quest to secure permanent appointment. So she wrote to management, which was acceptable. What was fearless is that she wrote also to the chairman of the board of directors. To my knowledge, that was not a practice then. And believe me, it didn't work. So, but she was appointed some 3 years later to the post of clerical officer. That letter was dated the 1st of December, 1988, and it came exactly 8 years from her date of employment. Resolute. Paula systematically commenced and continued various courses of study towards matriculation at the University of the West Indies. There she was accepted in 1992 to read for a Bachelor of Arts degree in History and Management Studies, which was successfully completed in 1997. Now, she had excellent time management skills, and those who know her know that she also had a very excellent memory. As an aside, during her period of studies and following her entering University of the West Indies, she managed successfully a courtship that resulted in marriage of two young Barbadians in St. Vincent and the Grenadines in July 1993. That was something that we don't have the secret to. Well, we didn't until Steve spoke, because we have quite a number of female officers at National Housing who've studied, and they're all still single. But Paula managed to balance both. So I think this evening Steve reminded us gently, trust in the Lord, and we must have some man out there praying faithfully for a wife. So that was the secret, girls. Just hold on. But so thus, all of Paula's personal records then changed from Miss Paula White to Mrs. Paula Blackmon, the wife of Steve Blackmon, and that was witnessed by close friend and colleague, Miss Petunia Cumberbatch. Paula was assigned to the personal section, where she continued to perform with excellence. The face of the personnel section quickly changed and started to represent its more updated function. So it was redesigned as the human resources section. That
change in the entire structure brought about the post of human resources officer, and Paula was appointed to one of those posts in June 2021. Now she continued to move upwards. She acted in a post called Manager of Administration and Office Services for several years, and then returned to the Human Resources section in 2009. Her quest for knowledge and the further strengthening of the Human Resources section propelled her to continue studying. So she engaged in her postgraduate studies, and she earned that Master's of Science, as our brother Boyne said. But thereafter, everything flowed to the position of Human Resources Manager, and she was permanently appointed to that post on the 1st of August 2018. Some persons, not all, get to realize the dreams and aspirations made for their career path. It is safe to say that Paula did. She was serious. She was committed to what she saw as a call on her life, her chosen career path. She has given in excess of 40 years of dedicated service to the National Housing Corporation. I say may she rest in peace with the God that she loved, she trusted, and she served for all those years. On behalf of the Honorable Minister of Housing, Lands, and Maintenance, who could not be here with us today, due to his national commitment today being Thursday. The chairman and board of directors, management and staff, and at staff I would still want to single out, there were some who were with Paula for the full journey. And over there I see Petunia coming back. Wendy Rock is also one we need to call, and I know Thyra McIntosh. So I take this opportunity to also extend specifically on their behalf. We offer our deepest condolences to husband Steve, to Carrie Ann, to all the siblings, some we know from National Housing over the years, and members of our family, immediate, and her church family. I thank you, and my name was, Fiona Goodrich.
Our very next hymn is number one that deals with To God Be the Glory. During this hymn, we're going to stand, and then we're going to collect an offering for the church upkeep. The deacons will signify where those baskets are. In the front. All right. So we walk up and bring your offering, but we're going to stand for this song, To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Have Done.
Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. seated. Pastor Padmore.
Good afternoon, everyone. Kindly bow your heads and pray with me. Father, now let the words of my mouth, the meditations of all hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. While I sat, I decided to begin my sermon this evening with at the end and come back to the front. On the 18th of May, probably around 9 o'clock in the morning, I got a call. I was on the landline and I got a call from Carrie Ann on the cell phone, and she said, Pastor, you can come now to the hospital. I said yes, and I hurried down to meet with her and Steve at Paula's bedside. We spent probably 3-4 hours just there on vigil, so to speak, as she was supported by the oxygen coming from the cylinder. Her eyes were closed. She was breathing heavily. We stayed there encouraging one another, praying. We knew that she could hear, and we were talking to her, singing, repeating hymns, just encouraging her in the Lord. Because, of course, you know, you got that call earlier from the doctor saying, come. So we were there just waiting. And then we had the most beautiful experience I've ever had as a pastor. And perhaps one that Steve and Carrie Ann would never forget. While we were there, so to speak, just waiting for her to breathe her last breath, something miraculous happened. All of a sudden, Paula just got up, eyes open bright, talking. Carrie Ann had the opportunity to hug her mother. She was so excited. Steve hugged his wife and kissed her and reaffirmed his love. Carrie Ann just popped out the cell phone and WhatsApp and as many family and friends as she could connect with. She just allowed Paula to speak to them right there and then at that moment. What a touching experience. So they saw husband Steve hugging and telling his wife how much he loved her, as Carrie Ann took her turn in hugging and kissing her mother and just having the WhatsApp going and letting all those who were inquiring about her mother's well-being to have that experience with her. But it was not for long. But while I enjoyed it while it lasted, and Steve and Carrie Ann would forever have that etched in their memories, I couldn't help but thinking in preparing the message for this afternoon about what excitement it will be when Jesus comes again. Let me say up front, brothers and sisters, it pays to serve the Lord. Let me say that again. It pays to serve the Lord. And I often say, not just to go to church or be a member of a church, but to have a personal experience with Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus assured Paula, and by extension, all those who serve him, as he was about to depart this earth, he said to his disciples in St. John chapter 14, verse 1-3, let not your what? heart be troubled. Why? Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. There's one with your name on it. You can't be content with living down here, waiting for a national housing unit. You may have to wait a long time, like I did. I applied 15 years, and then I got a call 15 years later and asked me if I got through with the unit. I had my house, but there's a mansion with your name written on it. My Jesus has assured that. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Now, Jesus is always true to every word or every promise he makes. He told his disciples, I will go and prepare a place. It means, therefore, Jesus could not have done that from the grave. He had to come forth from the grave. But then I read in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 9 to 11, that while he was about to go to prepare that place, as the disciples were there in conversation with him, two men stood by in white apparel and said to his disciples, Peter, James, and John, and the others, why stand ye there gazing up into heaven? Because by this time now, gravity had lost its hold and Jesus was going up to that place that he had promised that he will go to prepare for all who love him. I want to tell us, brothers and sisters, that was over 1900 years ago that Jesus went to prepare that place. And he says he will come again. Yes, there are many signs that would indicate his coming is near. We are into one right now. Pandemic, COVID-19, volcanic eruption, wars, pestilences. All of these things will happen prior to the coming of Jesus. But I want to tell you, brothers and sisters, that those will not prevent Jesus from coming, because he has promised and he always keeps his promises. And the good news is that even those who are serving him, like Paula did, even though they die and they will go to a grave, in our case, St. James Cemetery or Westbury or Mount Pleasant or wherever, the word of God reassures us that Jesus will come again. In the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the word of God says from verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. One day, our sister Paula will hear the voice of Jesus. He will call her by name, and she will come forth, not in this sickly body, but she will come forth in an immortal, glorified body. Somebody say hallelujah. When Jesus Christ comes again, every grave that contains the remains of those who died in Christ will come forth to a triumphant resurrection. I want to hasten to say this afternoon, brothers and sisters, though, that not every grave in St. James Cemetery where she will go will be open on the resurrection morning. Not every grave in Mount Pleasant, not every grave in Westbury, not every grave in St. Lucie, not every grave in every cemetery. When Jesus Christ comes the second time, 1 Thessalonians say that only those who lived for and died serving Jesus will come up. One Christian writer says, when Jesus heard that his friend Lazarus had died and he didn't come immediately, you know, I always say to myself, you know, as a pastor, If I perhaps had told Steve and Karima, I'm busy, I ain't coming right now, and perhaps Paula had died and I didn't turn up, perhaps they will hold me in their minds forever. We called you in our time of need to come. Jesus had a friend by the name of Lazarus that died, and the word got to him that Lazarus is sick. Come. Jesus didn't come the first day. He didn't go the second day. He didn't come the third day. He came the fourth day. As a matter of fact, when he turned up, Martha said, "But Jesus, you've come too late. If only you had been here, our brother had not died." Jesus went into that cemetery. One Christian writer says that Jesus, if he had gone into that cemetery and just say, "Come forth," every dead man and woman in that cemetery would have come up. But he wanted Lazarus in particular. So he went into that cemetery where Lazarus was, and he said, "Lazarus, it is you I've come for. Come forth." When Jesus comes again, all those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, all those who are right now, their bodies are contained in some cemetery across the world. When Jesus Christ comes again, all those who lived for and died serving Jesus, they will come forth in the first resurrection. I want to ask you a question, therefore. Let it be a rhetorical one. I ask and you don't answer verbally, but you still answer in your heart. Will you be in one of those graves on resurrection morning that will not budge, will not open? Not every grave will be uncovered. Only those who have lived for, and perhaps there are many persons, perhaps some of Paula's work colleagues, some of her friends, some of her families, some from her neighborhood, who always admired her and her commitment with Jesus and always promised one day, you know, "I'm going to serve the Lord like you do." But they never, ever made that commitment. What are you waiting for? Are you going to wait until it's too late? And don't be fooled, brothers and sisters. I normally say this at funerals. Don't be fooled that you can come like this and some pastor or some priest or some reverend going to put you in heaven. When you come before the minister, the most that he can do for you is to put you in the grave. He does not have the keys for heaven. Jesus is the one who has them. He determines who get there. I often say, as I bring this message to a close, when you die, nobody goes to heaven when they die. Oh, never heard that before. We all go to the grave. Rich man, poor man, black man, white man, Indian man, Chinese man, every man goes to the grave and remain there until Jesus comes. When he comes the second time, then those who have died serving him, there are only a few persons that Jesus, that God has given that privilege to be in heaven. And you've read about them in the Word of God. The Word of God says Enoch walked with God and was not, for God took him. Enoch is there. Who else is there? Moses is there. How do I know that? Because in the Mount of Transfiguration, it was Moses and Elijah that came and consoled Jesus. Who else is there? Elijah, Enoch, Moses. And then on resurrection morning, Jesus took some trophies when he came forth from the grave. Read in the book of the Gospels, Jesus took them, persons whom persons in the community knew had already died. Jesus brought them back to life and took them with him. But apart from that, all of us go to the grave and we remain there until Jesus comes. But you might ask the question, is it a problem for Jesus to put back dead people together? You know, Ezekiel was confronted in a conversation with God one day, and God took him into a valley with dry bones. All Ezekiel saw were some heads and some hands and some feet and body parts all scattered together, bones all together, all mixed up. You didn't know which was the head bone, which was female. And Ezekiel was asked a question. He asked God a question. God asked him a question first. Can these bones live?
Ezekiel didn't have the answer, but he was a bright guy. He said, God, you know. You know, because you, in the first instance, you were the one who took some dirt and formed man from the dust of the ground. You breathed life into that lifeless body, and man became a living soul. You are the one, because when Jesus comes again, all the bones in the various parts of the cemetery, it was that one just last week, Thursday, a week ago. And while I was there, I saw the grave diggers with what are those feed bags. Take it and throw it down inside the grave. I asked the minister who was there with me. You know what in there? She tell me somebody bones is just back in there. Will my God have a problem to put them back together again? Well, he didn't have a problem in putting them together in the first instance. He will do that one day. So I'm saying to you, Brother Steve, what a wonderful moment you had. Sharian, what a wonderful experience you had. But there's something greater. You had that. But then Paula slipped away into her sleep until Jesus comes. But one day, Brother Steve, one day, Sister Carrie-Anne, one day, brothers and sisters, Jesus will come. And all our loved ones who have lived for and died in Christ, we are going to have a grand reunion, never to part again. And I'm saying, brothers and sisters, you and I can be a part of that. But you've got to book your passage now. Can't wait till you die. I meet so many persons who used to come to church and they would say, Pastor, I'm coming back. And I often say to them, come back by yourself. Walk in the church. Because the day that six men hold you in one of these here and bring you up, you come too late. You got to come back alive. So I want to appeal in closing to some person here today who has been touched by Paula's life, who have been thinking for the longest while about making a commitment to Jesus Christ. You have been procrastinating, perhaps. You were brought up in the church. And you've left God for the longest while, and you've been procrastinating. You've been saying for the longest while, I can't come back one of these days. You know how many persons have been saying that, and that day never came? They came back, but dead. Then there are those who perhaps are right now in church, but as one friend of mine says, you know, you have one foot in the church and you have the other one on a banana skin. You just waiting right now to hear if they can got Kaduma this year and you gone down behind the truck. That's all you're waiting for. But you're still in the church. I'm saying, my sister, I'm saying, my brother, these are times to take some introspection of our lives. Is it well with my soul? What if my time were to come today? Is it well with my soul? I told another congregation, every one of us has an expiry date. You don't know yours. I don't know mine. One of these days, somebody's going to say, but hey, there's the man, there's the preacher. That preacher at Paula's funeral, wait, he in the obituaries. You can see me there one of these days. Or I might see you in there one of these days too. But the question is, what preparations have you made? Is it well with your soul? Are you one of those persons who will procrastinate? And finally, those who have no time, those who keep putting off, those who keep procrastinating will not come up in the first resurrection. They will come up 1,000 years later and they would remember and recall the opportunities, the time that Jesus knocked on their hearts, the time that they were convicted to give their hearts to the Lord, but not yet. One of these days, they did that until it was too late. We give God thanks for Paula's witness. We give God thanks for Paula's life. And we do not have to weep as others who have no hope. We can look forward this evening from here on by the grace of God that one day, if we remain faithful to Jesus for those who are serving him and for those who are not serving him right now, if you become faithful and serve Jesus, that one day you will be reconciled. You will one day see Paula again, never to have any sick, weak, emaciated bodies, never to have any cancer, never to have any of these plagues, these pandemics that come around. You will live in a body that will never ever die. That is God's plan. That's where he's gone to prepare. That's where he's coming soon. Let us be ready when Jesus comes so that he can say to us, well done, good and faithful servants. Enter into the joy of thy Lord. This is my prayer. And thanks be in Jesus' name.
Let us stand for the benediction. Let us pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. We will remain standing as we recess during the item of special music by Brother Gary Goodrich.
then they also which have fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If only in this life we have hope in Christ, we are all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive, but every man in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ's.
Beautiful shore in the sea, by and by.
tortured, but everybody knows this one. Because he lived, I can face tomorrow. Because he lived, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds life is worth living. Just because. You believe that? God sent his son, and they call him Jesus. God sent his son, they call him Jesus. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Oh, because he lives, all fear is gone. All fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future and life is worth.
Oh, allows me roll back as a scroll. Drum shall resound, and the Lord shall descend.
Thank you. Girl, listen. She's coming. Right, girl, listen, coming. Your lady coming. Right, your lady coming. You want to say that word with me? She's hooping it off with me. Right. I ain't sure.
After the prayer of committal, I want to meet with all the family members at this time. So immediately after the prayer of commitment, we can meet with all the family members on this day. So at this time, we go to reverently bow our heads. We can close our eyes. We can have some reverence. We can reverently bow our heads. We can close our eyes as we have the prayer. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. Hello. We can have prayer now. Let's have prayer. Our Father and our God, we give thee thanks for the life of our dear sister Paula. We are thankful, Lord, for the impact, the positive impact she has made on all of us, the church family, to her neighbors, to her colleagues, the impact she has made to her immediate family. We pray, Lord, that thou will comfort Brother Steve, continue to comfort Sister Harry. May they cherish the good times that they had together. We know, Lord, that you are the pilot and the head of every home. There comes a void, but we know, Lord Jesus, you can fill that void with the precious moments and the time is well spent with Paula. We pray, Lord, that your holy angels will mark this spot here this afternoon, this June 3rd of 2021. And we pray, Lord, that in that great end that morning, that our dear sister Paula will rise up in the first resurrection. In the meantime, Lord Jesus, may all of us prepare ourselves. May all of us witness and testify of your goodness. May we live every day as if it were the last. Bind the black man, bind Brother Steve Blackman, and Carrie and the family circle, bind them together in Christian love. And Lord Jesus, provide for them continually. And save the family, all the families, and the global family. Save us all, we pray. In Jesus' precious name. Let everybody say, amen. 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 All right? Okay, I just want to meet with the family members. All the aunts and the uncles and the extended family.